Harper Audio presents The Liar's Key by Mark Lawrence. Read by Sean Ohlendorf. Prologue. Two men in a room of many doors. One tall in his robes, stern, marked with cruelty and intelligence. The other shorter, very lean, his hair a shock of surprise, his garb a changing motley, confusing the eye. The short man laughs, a many-angled sound as likely to kill birds in flight as to bring blossom to the bough.
I have summoned you.
The tall man, teeth gritted as if still straining to hold the other in place, though his hands are at his side.
A fine trick, Kellem.
You know me?
I know everyone.
A sharp grin.
You're the door mage.
And you are?
Ecol.
His clothes change. Tattered yellow checks on blue, where before it was scarlet fleur-de-lis on grey.
Olic.
He smiles a smile that dazzles and cuts.
Loki, if you likey.
Are you a god, Loki?
No humour in Kellem. Only command. Command and a great and terrible concentration in stone grey eyes.
No.
Loki spins, regarding the doors.
But I've been known to lie.
I called on the most powerful.
You don't always get what you want.
Almost sing-song.
But sometimes you get what you need.
You got me. You are a god?
Gods are dull. I've stood before the throne, where Odin sits there, old One-Eye, with his ravens whispering into each ear.
Loki smiles.
Always the ravens. Funny how that goes.
I need...
Men don't know what they need. They barely know what they want. Odin, father of storms, god of gods, stern and wise, but mostly stern. You'd like him. And watching, always watching, oh, the things that he has seen.
Loki spins to take in the room.
Me? I'm just a jester in the hall where the world was made. I caper, I joke, I cut a jig. I'm of little importance. Imagine, though, if it were I that pulled the strings and made the gods dance. What if at the core, if you dug deep enough, uncovered every truth, what if at the heart of it all, there was a lie? Like a worm at the centre of the apple, coiled like Ouroboros, just as the secret of men hides coiled at the centre of each piece of you, no matter how fine you slice. Wouldn't that be a fine joke now?
Kellem frowns at this nonsense. Then, with a quick shake of his head, returns to his purpose.
I made this place from my failures.
He gestures at the doors. 13, lying side by side on each wall of an otherwise bare room.
These are doors I can't open. You can leave here, but no door will open until every door is unlocked. I made it so.
A single candle lights the chamber, dancing as the occupants move, their shadows leaping to its tune.
Why would I want to leave?
A goblet appears in Loki's hand, silver and overflowing with wine, as dark and red as blood. He takes a sip.
I command you by the 12 archangels of...
Yes, yes.
Loki waves away the conjuring. The wine darkens until it's a black that draws the eye and blinds it. So black that the silver tarnishes and corrupts. So black it is nothing but the absence of light. And suddenly, it's a key. A black glass key.
Is that...
There's a hunger in the door mage's voice.
Will it open them?
I should hope so.
Loki spins the key around his fingers.
What key is that? Not Acheron's. Taken from heaven when...
It's mine. I made it. Just now.
How do you know it will open them?
Kellum's gaze sweeps the room.
It's a good key.
Loki meets the Major's eyes.
It's every key. Every key that was and is, every key that will be, every key that could be.
Give it to...
Where's the fun in that?
Loki walks to the nearest door and sets his fingers to it.
This one.
Each door is plain and wooden, but when he touches it, this door becomes a sheet of black glass, unblemished and gleaming.
This is a tricky one.
Loki sets his palm to the door and a wheel appears. An eight-spoked wheel of the same black glass, standing proud of the surface, as if by turning it, one might unlock and open the door. Loki doesn't touch it. Instead, he taps his key to the wall beside it, and the whole room changes. Now it is a high vault, clean lines, walls of poured stone, a huge and circular silver steel door in the ceiling. The light comes from panels set into the walls. A corridor leads off, stretching further than the eye can see. 13 silver steel arches stand around the margins of the vault, each a foot from the wall, each filled with a shimmering light, as if moonbeams dance across water. Save for the one before Loki, which is black, a crystal surface fracturing the light, then swallowing it.
Open this door, and the world ends.
Loki moves on, touching each door in turn.
Your death lies behind one of these other doors, Kellum.
The mage stiffens, then sneers.
God of tricks, they...
Don't worry,
Loki grins.
You'll never manage to open that one.
Give me the key.
Kellum extends his hand, but makes no move toward his guest.
What about that door?
Loki looks up at the circle of silver steel.
You tried to hide that one from me.
Kellum says nothing.
How many generations have your people lived down here in these caves, hiding from the world?
These are not caves.
Kellum bridles. He pulls back his hand.
The world is poisoned. The day of a thousand suns.
Was 200 years ago.
Loki waves his key carelessly at the ceiling. The vast door groans, then swings in on its hinges, showering earth and dust upon them. It is as thick as a man is tall.
No!
Kellum falls to his knees, arms above his head. The dust settles on him, making an old man of him. The floor is covered with soil, with green things growing. Worms crawl, bugs scurry, and high above them, through a long vertical shaft, a circle of blue sky burns.
There. I've opened the most important door for you. Go out. Claim what you can before it all goes. There are others repopulating from the east.
Loki looks around as if seeking an exit of his own.
No need to thank me.
Kellum lifts his head, rubbing the dirt from his eyes, leaving them red and watering.
Give me the key.
His voice a croak.
You'll have to look for it.
I command you to.
But the key is gone. Loki is gone. Only Kellum remains. Kellum and his failures. Chapter 1. Petals rain down amid cheers of adoration. Astride my glorious charger at the head of Red March's finest cavalry unit. I led the way along the Street of Victory toward the Red Queen's palace. Beautiful women strained to escape the crowd and throw themselves at me. Men roared their approval. I waved. Bang, bang, bang. My dream tried to shape the hammering into something that would fit the story it was telling. I've a good imagination, and for a moment everything held together. I waved to the high-born ladies adorning each balcony, a manly smirk for my sour-faced brothers, sulking at the back of... Bang! 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 The tall houses of Vermilion began to crumble. The crowd started to thin, faces blurred.
Bang! Bang! Bang!
Ah, hell. I opened my eyes and rolled from the fur's warmth into the freezing gloom. Spring, they call this. I struggled shivering into a pair of shoes and hurried down the stairs. The tavern room lay strewn with empty tankards, full drunks, toppled benches, and upended tables. A typical morning at the Three Axes. Mirrors sniffed around a scatter of bones by the hearth, wagging his tail as I staggered in.
Bang! Bang!
All right, all right, I'm coming! Someone had split my skull open with a rock during the night. Either that, or I had a hell of a hangover. Damned if I knew why a Prince of Redmarch had to answer his own front door, but I'd do anything to stop that pounding tearing through my poor head. I picked a path through the detritus, stepped over Eric Threeteeth's ale-filled belly to reach the door, just as it reverberated from yet another blow. God damn it, I'm here! I shouted as quietly as I could. Teeth gritted against the pain behind my eyes. Fingers fumbled with the lock bar, and I pulled it free.
What?
And I hauled the door back.
What?
I suppose with a more sober and less sleep-addled mind, I might have judged it better to stay in bed. Certainly that thought occurred to me as the fist caught me square in the face. I stumbled back, bleating, tripped over Eric, and found myself on my arse staring up at Astrid, framed in the doorway by a morning considerably brighter than anything I wanted to look at.
You bastard!
She stood hands on hips now. The brittle light fractured around her, sending splinters into my eyes, but making a wonder of her golden hair and declaring in no uncertain terms the hourglass figure that had set me leering at her on my first day in Tron.
What?
I shifted my legs off Eric's bulging stomach and shuffled backward on my behind. My hand came away bloody from my nose.
Angel! Sweetheart!
You bastard!
She stepped after me, hugging herself now, the cold following her in.
Well?
I couldn't argue against bastard, except technically. I put my hand in a puddle of something decidedly unpleasant and got up quickly, wiping my palm on Mira's, who'd come over to investigate, tail still wagging, despite the violence offered to his master.
Hedvig Versorin?
Astrid had murder in her eyes. I kept backing away. I might have half a foot over her in height, but she was still a tall woman with a powerful right arm.
Oh, you don't want to believe street talk, my sweets?
I swung a stool between us.
It's only natural that Jarl Sorin would invite a Prince of Redmarch to his halls once he knew I was in town. Hedwig and I...
Hedvig and you what?
She took hold of the stool as well.
Nothing, really.
I tightened my grip on the stool legs. If I let go, I'd be handing her a weapon. Even in my jeopardy, visions of Hedwig invaded my mind. Brunette, very pretty, wicked eyes, and all a man could want packed onto a short but inviting body.
We were barely introduced.
It must have been a pretty bare introduction, if it has Jarl Sorin calling out his housecarls to bring you in for justice.
Oh, shit.
I let go of the stool. Justice, in the north, tends to mean having your ribs broken out of your chest.
What's all the noise?
A sleepy voice from behind me. I turned to see Edda, barefoot on the stairs, our bedfurs wrapped around her middle, slim legs beneath, and milk-pale shoulders above, her white blonde hair flowing across them. Turning away was my mistake. Never take your eye off a potential foe, especially after handing them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.